used to introducing myself. I just get up and just talk to people. But at a very young age, I became interested in crystals and pyramids and all those kind of things, and just was fascinated by all of that. By the time I was 15, I was in an ashram. I joined the Hare Krishnas and was enjoying life in a very meditative lifestyle. Then around about 18 or 19, I started having a few interesting spiritual experiences. One of them was a Kundalini awakening, and another was the sacred Vedic literatures began to open themselves up in a rather internal sense, is the only way I can put it. I could read them, and then I could start to see a deeper layer to them, which there wasn't really any explanation for it at that stage. Around the same time, I had some other people in my life talk to me about Jesus, and I'm like, yes, I know who Jesus is. He's a, you know, avatar teacher, you know. But I had this burning question to know exactly where Jesus fit into the picture of all of this. And that's when I had an encounter with the Lord. He appeared to me, and I knew, well, I need to follow this path, because that's what had happened to me. So I began to visit normal churches and began to realize something wasn't quite right. But just going with that experience of having sacred text opening for me, I found that the Bible also began to open itself in its archetypes and its spiritual symbology and teach itself to me. It was probably many years before I discovered Swedenborg, but what a delight it was for me to find him, because here I was trying all on my own to try and understand what this opening of the inner sense of the word was really all about. I got to the point where I realized the second coming of Jesus was going to be a spiritual event, not some physical event. You know, I'd been taught by churches that the sky will rip open, Jesus will come down, you know, the usual. But then I began to realize, no, that from the scripture itself, it was opening and teaching me from the archetypes in there that the second coming was something different, that it actually happens inside each one of us, if we're open to it, of course, which you would think of probably more in terms of Christ consciousness, I suppose. That would probably make more sense. Yeah. Okay, so that's my journey. And somewhere along the line, Brisbane said, please, would you come and pastor the church there? And I said, okay. And that was about 10 years ago. So here we are. I'm going to move straight into the talk here, because talking about the golden age, as you're probably aware, from a fundamentalist Christian point of view, there is no golden age as they see it. There's kind of the end of the world. Yes? Mm-hmm. End of the world, and then, well, I suppose if you're lucky enough, you might get to be on the other side of whatever that is. But that's not what scripture actually teaches, and it's not what Swedenborg was shown. But I don't want to just assume everybody here. I know that everyone here is on a spiritual path of some kind. But I don't want to assume that everyone here is even expecting a golden age. You might have a different understanding. So I want to take a moment first explaining how I hold to this idea of a golden age coming and what that golden age means. Doesn't want to work. Press the button. No. Maybe I'll try this. Ah. Maybe I get people to give me a show of hands while I get this technology to work. Who has a sense of a coming golden age? And most people in the room accept that there is some kind of transformation taking its place in the human race. Is that working?
Yeah.
Look at that. I just turned it off. There we go. Okay, let's go back to the Vedic literature. That's where I spent years, a lot of teaching, a lot of studying in the Vedic literature. And they themselves talk about ages, beginning with the Satya Yuga, which would last for around about 1.7 million of our years. Somewhere around that. I mean, everybody has a different way of calculating it, but it's a very long time. And it is, in fact, called the Golden Age by those who study the Vedic literature. And it represents a period of time where people automatically had a connection with the divine. Everybody understood that our earthly life was a part of something greater. part of our spiritual life. But Satra Yuga then eventually moves into Treta Yuga, which would last for about 1.2 million. Each time the ages descend, there's a loss of about 25% of time. So there's kind of a shortening, like a spiral getting smaller each time. Moving into, and that would be like the Silver Age. Moving into Dwapara Yuga, you'd have about 800,000 years. And around this stage, there's a lot of war, a lot of conflict. You know, the human race is very confused about where it is. And then we move into, does anyone know where we go next?
Kali Yuga.
Yeah, pretty much. Most people, you know that. Kali Yuga. Does anybody know why Kali?
Darkness and death.
Darkness and death, the wife of Shiva. Yeah, it's symbolically in Vedic literature a time of death, but in reality, as Swedenborg was shown, there is no death. Death is really just the loss of the body and us moving into a higher conscious state. But certainly Kali Yuga is the dark period. And Vedic literature kind of says, you know, demons walking the earth in flesh suits. That's kind of how it actually puts it, you know. Which really is just saying to me that we become very, very self-absorbed. Really, we become extremely selfish, self-absorbed. A race of narcissistic people, a human race of narcissists. The Dark Age, which lasts for around about 400,000 years, and then, of course, back into Satra Yuga we return. So there's a return again, which is wonderful and hopeful, which is why you would say there must be, or at least from a Vedic literature point of view, must be a shift coming, and we're heading into possibly some kind of a golden age. But where might we be on that shift, on that spectrum? If we look in the scriptures, the Bible, we get a similar kind of archetype. Here, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream, and it takes a prophet, Daniel, to help him understand what that dream is about. But Daniel explains that the statue made of gold, silver, bronze, and iron represents different ages, and that Nebuchadnezzar was a type of golden age, ruling the earth, Babylon ruling the earth in a beautiful way. But of course, every culture has its descent, and then of course we come down into the Persians ruling, then we have Greece ruling, and we have the two legs of Rome, which is really interesting too, because today we have a real divide, isn't it? Mm. There is a real divide, a real polarization. It's gotten worse even in the last few years, between East and West, like those two legs. But in the vision given to Nebuchadnezzar, a great rock from the sky comes down and hits the base of the statue, and it can no longer stand, it crumbles. So from biblical archetypes, we call that the fall of Babylon. Or the fall of Babylon. But that fall of Babylon, let's understand, Babylon is that part of us that seeks to manipulate and control each other. It's our lower ego, that desire that wants to dominate each other, where the goal is to actually transcend that into the angelic ego, the one that wants to love and serve and care for people. So the fall of Babylon on a personal level is really about your spiritual awakening. And who could put their hand up by saying that my spiritual awakening was rather disturbing, shocking? Someone up the back there, you know, says definitely it was shocking. For the rest of you, well done. You can pray for me later if it wasn't shocking. But this is where we come to the idea of Buddhism, right? They don't talk about ages, but they do talk about the fact that when we go through our spiritual awakening, truth actually equals destruction. But destruction of what? Here's a quote. Nirvana is not a destination. It's annihilation. What gets annihilated is the thing that suffers, not who you really are. So what's getting annihilated here? Our ego. Our false ego, isn't it? And that's why awakening, spiritual awakening, can be rather a rather rough event. It can be a very disturbing thing. Now, we talk about a coming golden age. Where might we be? I'm speculating we're around about 100 years, maybe 120 years into it. And that was actually Madame Blavatsky's view of it too, you'll see soon. But before I go there, let's talk about shamanic practices. They too also talk about these kind of disturbing awakenings, that spiritual awakening is something disturbing. They call the night of shamanic awakening. And in that culture, if you had an emotional or a mental disturbance, trouble, you were not mentally ill. You were more than likely special, and you were actually having an awakening. Let that sink in for a moment. You know, here in our current society, if you're having mental issues, well, you need a drug of some kind. It's true. Where rather than realizing maybe something's going on in terms of an awakening inside you. So a shaman would go, I know what this is. Let me take this young person as my apprentice or whoever and would work with them. But what would happen next? For us in the new church, we think of this in terms of the 7 days of spiritual practice. Genesis 1, yes. God created, on day one, God created light. But there was also chaos. Then on day two, God created a separating of the waters from above and below. That's us learning to get out of our ego and learn to come, like a Buddhist, come into a place of non-judgmental observation of your life. Day three, new earth. Think of Eckhart Tolle. You know, out of the waters of chaos, your deep subconscious mind, arises something you can now stand on. Convictions, values, conscience. Day four, the sun, moon and stars and the seasons. That's so actually this, by the way, is a cycle we go through a lot, all the time. In fact, this is where we live. Our goal is to live in day seven, peace. But we've got to get there. So we'll go through the cycle again and again and again until a day four event happens where sun, moon and stars and seasons and times talks about special guidance. Ever seen 1111 everywhere? Or some other number? Or ever found yourself having a conversation with someone and they say that word, you've been hearing it all week? Well, you shouldn't ignore those. That's a day four event. You're having a special leading by the divine. Which then leads to an expansion of your spiritual life. Day five, all of your subconscious mind, all the deep waters, are filled with fish. So there's new knowledge expanding in you. And then all of the birds of the air are filling the trees. Trees are perception. Now, if it's a toxic tree, then maybe your perception of things is not so good. But if it's a good, fruitful tree. So the birds of the air are filling your sky and filling the trees. So this is an expansion time in your spiritual life. And there's a lot of people that mistake that expanding period for the rest of the divine, and it's not. So you're flourishing, but you're being built up for what the shamans call that dark night, the dark night of the soul. That's day six. And that's where all the warm-blooded animals were created, including us. And you think, okay, how does that, the dark night of the soul? Well, warm-blooded meaning love. This is where love is first truly breaking forth into our consciousness. Most of what we call love before that is really a self-interest. You know, I'm invested in this, but I'm getting a lot out of it. It's not true unconditional love. But the moment you experience love, unconditional love, you become a target for dark energy. Mm-hmm. Is it not true?
Yes.
That's why this leads to the dark night of the soul. But once you've come through that, then you come into the rest. Okay? So shamans would see, you know, young people and say, okay, they're having an awakening here. Let me work with them. Now, in that context, you have a day six event. For a shaman, it would usually occur in this kind of a way. That young person would start having very disturbing dreams. There'd be something chasing. Ever had a dream where someone's chasing you or something's chasing you? And you just cannot get away. And it's like, you know, you're running. And no matter how hard you try, you just can't get enough energy to get away. That's an awakening trying to occur in you, but the lower ego not understanding it is running. Oh, okay. We all do that. We all do it. But what the shaman will teach this young person is, you know, usually it's like a large reptile, a snake, and that's not by coincidence, by chance. It's by design, sorry. This large reptile or snake will be fighting and wrestling with this person, and the shaman will say, let it devour you. Oh, that's wonderful. Let it, in your dream, let it devour you. Because this is that process of death and resurrection. That cycle of going, I'm going to surrender, And when, of course, the serpent or snake or whatever would consume that person, the dreams would stop. They'd start having a proper awakening, that next step. But I find that fascinating, because where else do we find this same kind of archetypes repeating themselves like that? Well, the Bible's one of them, isn't it? In the beginning, what took Adam and Eve, which is basically, Adam and Eve is basically the ancient people, not two literal people, but the ancients who lived in a garden state of consciousness, until the serpent led them out of that. Who'd like to know what the serpent is? It's your sensual. It's your sensual. It's your eyes, your ears, your nose, your mouth. It's your sensual.
Okay.
Which leads you away from what is spiritual, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah.
It's our sensual. But when we learn to trust, this is why, you know, science is valuable, but science that is purely built on what the senses can detect is not only faulty, but it's dangerous. Mm. Isn't it? It's dangerous.
Mm.
That's why I love quantum science, because they're really pushing the boundaries of where science needs to go. Okay, so this kind of awakening for a shaman, we also get that in the Vedic literature, don't we? I talked earlier about having a kundalini awakening, where I was actually in a deep meditation, I fell asleep, and all I could see was a deep, dark tunnel, which was looking down my spine, I figured out later on. And I could see sparking, just shoots of blue energy. And it was coming closer, I didn't know what it was, it was getting closer and closer, and then it just engulfed my consciousness. And I woke up and it felt like my head was being torn off my shoulders. I nearly lost it, right? And that's what they call a kundalini awakening, right? Where all the different chakras, starting at your feet, right, your anus, your feet, your loin, your groin, stomach, heart, throat, eyes, and transcendence, are now being connected. But Vedic literature uses this archetype of a snake. When you've had a proper spiritual awakening, there is no conflict between the sensual and the spiritual. They become one, isn't it? We all know that, because you'll be going along in your life and you'll just hear something, but you're hearing it with spiritual ears. You'll just know something, you'll see something, you'll sense something, you'll have an image go through your mind. We've pretty much all experienced that at some point. So there's this idea, even in the Vedic literature, of the snake, the serpent, and the need for us to rise up. And the scripture says, even as Moses lifted the serpent, the brass serpent, up in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, isn't it? Which is talking about us coming up into Christ consciousness. It's being lifted up with the Lord, rather than being down in that sensual level. Is that okay? I'm not losing anyone with that? No, okay. But where I am going with this is the idea that truth is first destructive for you. It's really kind of tears the fabric of what you thought reality was apart, doesn't it? And now we're all wanting a golden age, yes? Who wants a golden age? But what we're really asking for is the whole human race to go through a shock treatment. We want the human race to wake. And that's gonna have some, you know, fun aspects to it. I've got a little video here I'd like to play for you. I tried to play it two sacred circles ago and the technology messed up, so you're going to get to enjoy it tonight. By the way, this is not for medical information, this is for entertainment only. Okay, I hope the volume's there, let's see if it's there. What is it like to have a spiritual awakening? Rapid crumbling of your reality. Loss of friends. Loss of family. Fear of being insane. Now you get a moment to pause and think about it. What just happened? Not so bad. We're not finished yet. Ton of shadow work. Holding on to the last vestiges of your old reality. Ego death. What just happened?
What in the hell was that all about?
Isn't that true? I mean, like, most of us are laughing here right now. But why are we laughing? Because, you know, reality is quite funny. You know, when something's true, we laugh because that's exactly what your spiritual awakening would have been like at some point in your life. Or maybe you're still going through it. I don't know. We're all at different stages here in our spiritual awakening. And we're kind of asking the whole human race to go through that. Does that kind of make some sense now why maybe the divine might say, let's drag this out. Let's not just snap the fingers and suddenly the whole human race is away, because you'd be in a nightmare, isn't it?
True.
But it's unfolding gradually. Okay, and except for most of us who are leading the charge, it's usually a little bit more disturbing and we kind of get knocked about a bit and then we're asked to talk about this. Stand up the front and talk about it. And I'm looking at every one of you people too. Okay, so this idea of a golden age. Where are we in this golden age? I've got a quote here for you from Madame Blavatsky herself. This was from, I think, her last book she wrote, or one of the last things she wrote in 1889. She says here, "Consider all this, and then tell me whether I am too sanguine when I say that if the Theosophical Society survives," and it did, interesting, "and lives true to its mission, to its original impulses, through the next 100 years, so we're there, she goes on to say, well, could you see that? "Tell me, I say, if I go too far in asserting that the earth will be a heaven in the 21st century in comparison to what it is now." It's very insightful, isn't it? I mean, it's almost like she kind of knew that the 20th century, right? World War I, Great Depression, World War II, Korean War, Vietnam War, we had, you know, Berlin Wall. We ended the century with bombing in Iraq and Desert Storm and all of that. We just had like a whole century of just wars. It's kind of like she kind of knew, even though she knew we were coming into the age of Aquarius, back at the turn into the 20th century, she's kind of like, we're going to have to skip 100 years, and if we make it through that, the 21st century is going to be like heaven compared to that, isn't it? I think that's just fascinating what she said there. Let's not forget, though, that we're a quarter of a way through the 21st century already, aren't we? Is it heaven yet? It's a mixture of feelings. Say after me, it is heaven. No, it is heaven in my heart. Amen. That's right. That's where we're really going to experience it, isn't it? In here. Okay, so we go back 120 years earlier. 20 years, yeah. We can have... So what Madame Blavatsky, I believe, was talking about there is what we in the New Church call New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven. Right? This is where Christians say, end of the world, everyone's dead, and everyone's resurrected. No, it's New Jerusalem descending down out of heaven to affect the consciousness of the human race. That's what Swedenborg was showing. So go back to 150 years. Let's have a look at what Swedenborg had to say about the golden age. Okay. He found, when he was 57 years of age, had a spiritual awakening. He fell down the hill and said, what was that all about? But differently, he was able to stay in both consciousnesses for the rest of his life, for another 27 years, I think it was. He was able to be physically present and actually traversing in the spiritual world and documenting everything he saw. He's like, yeah, okay, so the Christians got that right. They got this right. They got that right. Yep, yeah. Whoa, I really messed this up. So he started to sort of correct a lot of the problems there, okay? Including the idea that, you know, the second coming was going to be like some kind of wiping out the race and starting again. It's not. The second coming is about lifting us up, the whole race, up into heaven. Or, as it appears to us, New Jerusalem coming down. But here, what happens then is that the Bible starts with a garden. But it ends with that same garden, except now it's been upgraded. It's got technology. It's got cities. It's got streets of gold. It's got all sorts of things added to it. Hopefully everyone here had a blissful childhood. If you didn't, my thoughts are with you. But let's say you all had a blissful childhood. There's your garden, right there, isn't it? When we're children, we're living in a kind of garden consciousness, much like the ancients did. Then puberty hits, and you've got to get a job, and you've got to work, and you've got to survive, and it's just, it's like we're thrust out, isn't it? But if we do our process right, we're going to make our way right through the whole process until we get the garden descending back, but now with that new technology, with the cities. So there it is, streets of gold, the river's there, the tree of life's there, there's all that beautifulness, but there's more. So this whole idea of where we're going, this golden age, to me, this is what I honestly believe, it's we've gone through these cycles, these again and again, these cycles, again, for possibly millions of years. And now, through this introduction of Christ consciousness, Swedenborg says that when New Jerusalem comes, or this golden age comes, it won't end. You won't go through 1.7 million years and then down again. Now that sounds really good to me. I hope it's true. I think it is. But let's look at what he does say. It lines up a lot with Madame Blavatsky. He says that as this golden age unfolds over the centuries, we would experience greater spiritual collaboration. And we are. We'll experience greater freedom. Now that one's key. Hold on to that. I'll come back to it. We'll have the fall of this Babylonic egocentric control system, and it'll be replaced with love. People will be able to love each other. And this is because there's all sorts of shifts going on in the spiritual world. We all feel it. Who's really felt it even in the last 6 months? A lot of major shifting going on, isn't it? There's a lot of stuff going on. Okay, there will be greater understanding around our purpose and our meaning. There would be a much stronger divine connection. There would be an acceleration of wisdom. That sounds good. And this last one's my favourite. We will all have an expanded capacity to love each other. Boy, could we do with more of that? Mm-hmm. Unconditional love. We could really do with that, a lot more of that. But let's come back to this idea of freedom. Because what we find, this is all from The Last Judgment, Swedenborg's book, The Last Judgment. This is quite fascinating what he says next. He says, the future state of the world will be exactly the same as it has been up till now. For the mighty change which has taken place in the spiritual world does not cause any change in the external appearance of the natural world. I think, is that right? Well, we didn't grow any extra heads. We haven't got more arms. We didn't manifest a third eye on our skull, did we? So, for all intents and purposes, the external world isn't necessarily changing. But we are. That's what he goes on to talk about. He says, so just as before, there will be politics. Oh, really? Yes. There will be peace treaties. There will be alliances and even wars. And all other general and particular features of society. And I can remember reading that and going, oh, really? But you think about this whole century that Madame Blavatsky decided to skip. She said, you know, give it 100 years. If we survive that 100 years, it's going to be more heavenly-like compared to where we're at now. So that's interesting. But this is what he does say, and I find this so fascinating, and I know you're going to resonate with this. He says, the future state of spiritual communities, however, will not be the same. It may seem the same in outward appearance, okay? No extra heads, no forearms, all that sort of stuff. But inwardly, they will be different. In outward appearance, spiritual communities will be divided from one another as before. Their teachings will differ as before. So will the religious systems of the world. And that's why you keep coming back here on Wednesday nights to hear lots of different talks. Because there's lots of different opinions. Okay, and that's okay. Because he goes on to say, but people in spiritual communities will henceforth have more freedom in thinking. Hasn't that been true? You think about the dark periods where there was, you know, the ruling of churchianity. Isn't it? That was the best spirituality we had for a long time. It's very dark. How much more freer are we in our thinking, in our understanding, in our freedom to explore? Isn't it? That's wonderful. And that's only going to get better. It says we will become freer in our thinking about matters of faith, and so about spiritual matters which have to do with heaven, because of the restoration of spiritual freedom. For now, everything in the heavens and the hells has been restored to order. It is from there that all thought is influenced about divine matters or against them. It is because people have their spiritual freedom restored that the spiritual sense of the word has now been disclosed. Now, he says elsewhere, the spiritual sense of all sacred texts, which kind of explains why, you know, here I was in the Hare Krishnas reading the sacred text, and I started having that opening to a deeper sense, doesn't it? And you will all find this, because this is not, it's not something to just one person. The Lord has shifted things so that we can now, even as Madame Blavatsky talked about, go back to those occult or hidden things, those secret hidden things. We can read sacred text and it speaks to us, doesn't it? Each one of us, it'll speak to us in a unique way. That is a gift of the golden age that's coming. Any sacred text can now open itself and reveal itself to you. It's that spiritual meaning, that deeper spiritual meaning. So the word is now being disclosed, and by this means, divine truths of a more inward kind have been revealed. Okay, so let's go back to the foundation of the Theosophical Society. To form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity without distinction of race, creed, sex, caste, or colour. That was, what, 120-something years ago that was written down? To encourage the study of comparative religion, philosophy, and science. You can do it now, because even though there are fundamentalists holding on to their belief systems, if you pick up any sacred text, it will open itself to you. The spiritual sense is what I'm talking about, because that's a part of this age we're coming into. And of course, to investigate unexplained laws of nature and powers that are latent in the human being. Now, I wanted to comment briefly on the Theosophical Society's statement of mission statement. Is that the right word for it? Mission statement? Yeah. I love this. There is no religion higher than truth. But is it okay if I just tweak things a little bit there? Okay, all right. I just want to put a little bracket in here. Just a little bracket. And stick the word integrated truth in there. Is that okay? Because I've experienced, I'm sure you have, that when you approach truth philosophically, just from a purely intellectual point of view, you need to at first. But if that's your goal, your only goal, you'll get stuck. You will get stuck. But when you learn to integrate truth, we discover what Swedenborg was showing. Truth is love. When it's integrated, they're no different. Truth is love. So for me, I just kind of, there is no religion higher than love. But I love the way this is kind of getting back to how we do it. We've got to integrate truth into us, or, you know, or your love isn't going to be love. It'll really just be an extension of your ego. So I think it's a fantastic motto. But have a look at this picture I have here, because this again comes back to this idea of all of us have been studying the truth somewhere along the line in different fields, yeah? And we're trying to piece it together. We're trying to figure out what's going on here. So you go, oh yeah, there's a woman's face there. There's a door. Anyone else help? You know, like there's an old person. I think that, you know, what am I looking at? But as soon as we get big picture, which is what integrating truth does, we go, oh, I never saw that before. The divine human. The divine human. Why didn't I see that before? When you approach truth on the intellectual level only, you're going to be stuck back there. You're going to be stuck back at looking at individual pieces. But the integrating of it pulls you into a place where your consciousness can lift and you can start to see that bigger picture. So I thought that was a really good example. But let's have a look. Another thing that really impressed me that Madame Blavatsky did is she protected the society. Because as we go back into these ancient traditions, and you see the different descent of ages that we've gone through, their practices have become more and more selfish. And a lot of what we have record of is distorted practices. Now, like I said to you, you're living in the golden age where you can read the text and it will speak to you. And she made that point. And in the Vedic literature, there were different kinds of vidyas or knowledges. There's like jnana, mahavidya, there's gujavidya. But one that she brought up, which I was really impressed with, was atmavidya. Atma and paramatma, you've probably heard those words before. Mm-hmm. In the Bhagavad Gita. You are an atma. You are a spark of the divine. But you are not the divine. That's a mistake to think you are. And I love using this analogy. We used it recently, didn't we? You know, if you ate food tonight, most people here ate food tonight. Did you have to focus on digesting that food? Breaking it down into millions of little pieces and sending it off to different parts of the body? What a relief. You just got the joy of eating it and enjoying it. That's the gift of the Atma. Paramatma takes care of the rest. So when we learn our right relationship to God, that's all Atma Vidya is. Self-realization. That we're a part of a greater whole. Our purpose is to love each other unconditionally. Not going to happen but straight away, but it takes work. Spiritual work. Okay? And she said, Atma Vidya, a term which is translated simply to knowledge of the soul, true wisdom by the Orientalists, but which means far more, this last kind of knowledge of the occultism, that any theosophist who admires light on the path and who would be wise and unselfish ought to strive after. Mm-hmm. You know what I think she's talking about here? Mm-hmm. She's talking about this golden age as we go into it. You're each going to develop your own practice of connecting with the divine. Think about that. You already do. I have my practices that mostly I get outside. Now, I can do it when I'm inside, but if I can get outside for a moment and just pause and be meditative, I can reconnect with the divine and then carry that with me. I call them powerful positive moments that daily I try and have many of them, connect with them. Okay, and I'm talking about this because as we go into this golden age, the archetypes shown us in the Bible warn us. Let's have a look. Okay, coming into this golden age, where exactly are we? Well, I'm speculating, like Madame Blavatsky did in the book, that we're roughly 100 or so, 100 years into an unfolding age, right? Somewhere like that. Okay, the archetypes in sacred text for this coming age is a woman clothed with the sun, pregnant, ready to give birth. She has 12 stars around her head. Think 12 constellations that dominate our sky. And there is your snake or your serpent at its penultimate, right? The natural sciences and everything that's sensual reached its penultimate, trying to devour the child that's going to be birthed. Mm. So this here is actually the archetype for Earth, but particularly those in Earth that are awakening, right? Us, hopefully, us. And what are we giving birth to? The man-child, that Christ consciousness that we want to see take over the whole planet, isn't it? And the sensual is trying to devour it. Now, this archetype comes up all through sacred texts, right even in the garden. But let's have a quick, I'll go through it quickly and have a look at it with you, just so you can see. And it's important that we understand this archetype because it teaches us something about the coming of the Golden Age that we all need to really be prepared for. This is straight from the Gospels. Truly, truly, I say unto you, you shall weep and lament. The world shall rejoice, and you shall be sorrowful. But your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in labour, has sorrow because her hour has come. But as soon as she has given birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish, for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So awakening, spiritual awakening, is like giving birth. Is that okay? And I'm sorry, ladies, I don't really know what the... Spiritual awakening is like giving birth. And it comes with a contraction after a contraction after a contraction and exhaustion and what the hell was that all about? Isn't it? It's true. Okay, and that's the archetype that the scripture gives, is a woman giving birth. But it promises us that when we come through that, we forget. We forget all the pain that's gone before, and we're now in ecstasy that something new has taken place inside us. Yes? I'm not boring you, I hope. Okay, and the Lord God said unto the serpent, this is right out of Genesis 2, because you have done this, you are cursed above all cattle and above every beast and above the field, and upon your belly shall you go, and dust shall you eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. It shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. It's this idea again of the sensual. We all have to deal with our sensual side as spiritual practitioners, isn't it? and this war between our sensual side and our spiritual side as we learn to give birth to that higher ego. And we're wanting this for the whole planet. So it's probably a good thing that this is unfolding gradually. COVID? Ugh. Contraction. You know? These things are waking people up, aren't they? It is. We're going through these. Now, I'm bringing this up here because if I leave you with anything tonight, is that spiritual work is not all rainbows and unicorns and puppies and all that stuff, but also that on a planetary level, we need to be ready for that awakening as it comes in its contractions, yes? Yeah. Look, I'll run through a few more quickly, a few more archetypes, and then we'll close. Before she was in labor, this is Isaiah, before she was in labor, she gave birth. Before her pain came, she delivered a male child. Who has heard of such a thing? Who has seen such things? Shall the earth be made to give birth in one day? Remember, a day is 1,000 years. Shall the earth be made to give birth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion was in labor, she gave birth to her children. So there's this idea there of the 7 days that we're going through, except we're talking about going through it on a global scale. It's going to be quite challenging. But what I want you to leave with you tonight, and I hand these out, but I won't do it until I'm finished, because if I hand them to you, you'll start reading it for sure. I've written down here the 7 practices of the 7 days, what they represent, our spiritual practice. And as I said before, the goal is to get to day 7, rest and peace. Every day I'm seeking to just function out of peace, because peace is the most practical form of love. It's the most practical form of love, to be in peace. When you're not in peace, you're not loving anyone, let alone yourself. Peace is to be in this peace, because the more we can ground ourselves in the divine and in that peace, the more we're able to deal with the contractions that the planet is going through. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay. And I have my ways of doing that. You'll all have your ways of doing that. But I'm just going to leave it there. I'll hand these out. Maybe you could just start passing them around. Maybe we could have a 5-10 minutes of questions about what we're talking about. Maybe you want to throw stones at me and kick me out. I don't know. Or maybe you've been encouraged by what I'm saying. But what I don't want to do is tell you happy, happy, joy, joy, and not actually prepare you for real, real spiritual work. Mm. So is there questions?
Questions?
Comments?
I'll do one.
Yes.
Yeah, I've been following the sort of New Age stuff all my life, but I'm just observing human nature. And there's a percentage of people who are probably out there doing it, but there's a high percentage who become acutely selfish. And the suicide rate is going pretty serious.
Yes.
Yeah, and this age that we're getting closer and closer to, especially children, which is really sad. The child suicide right now is just off the planet. And so I'm just looking for some sort of marker for, you know, the future, because I see things that are horrifying, to be honest.
Yep, and that is such a good point that he's making there. If you use your natural senses to look out there, what you see is horror, isn't it? And it's like golden age. That's why I kind of started by saying, you know, everyone's going to be in a different spectrum on if there is a golden age and where we're going, because it just seems to be getting darker and darker. But here's the fact. It gets coldest before sunlight. Not darkest. It gets... I mean, there's more light on the planet, really. Come on. There really is. I don't mean globally. I just mean we can all access more light, can't we? But look how cold it is out there. There's a lot of that coldness, isn't it? But like the statue, as you go down the legs, right, there's that polarization going on. Okay. You don't have to look at America to look at the polarizing that's going on, right? And this is a part of that rock hitting that system and that system crumbling.
Yeah, the feet of clay.
The feet of clay, yeah. Exactly. Right. The feet of clay. There's not even anything strong in it, is it?
No.
At least iron is strong. The feet were made of clay, thank you, mixed with iron, yeah. But that rock hitting it, you know, we're not going to build this golden age and New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven on our current blood economy. If anyone knows what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, this economy it's built on where you're taxed for breathing, literally. Mm-hmm. You know, it makes a few rich and the rest of us suffer. Mm-hmm. There's got to come a shift. And it's tragic to see what's happening is it's actually always been like this for a long time, but now as that light gets brighter and we feel the coldness of it, we're being confronted with it more than ever.
Can I do a quick add-on? The ascension, my understanding of it, we go for astrological stages. I think every 26,000 years we do a soul separation. So not everyone who is around now will be a part of the coming golden age, to give it. Some people just go back astrologically to the beginning and do the 26,000 years. That's my perception. How do you see it?
Well, I've no problem with that. I mean, if that sits for you and that's where you're at, that's great. I think what is important for me, and as I study Vedic literature and then I began to study the archetypes of the scriptures, is that something is changing in our cycles, so that we're not going to have these cycles of downward and then back up again and downward. You know, we're shifting. So this golden age, which is taking a long time to come, but it's coming, is going to change us for good. You know?
Wow.
On many levels. So that's exciting.
You're saying that all the religions are saying basically the same thing.
They are, definitely at the spiritual sense.
Really?
On the literal sense, they take different clothing. I mean, everyone here put clothing on before you came tonight. But if we stripped you all naked, you'd have all the same anatomy.
Yeah.
And so it is that true spiritual religions have the same anatomy, same bones, the same. But we take different clothing to deal with different ages and different consciousnesses and different cultures.
The aim is to get the Shabbat as a Jewish core.
Yes, well, when I had my awakening and I came out of the Hare Krishnas, I actually, you know, the Lord appeared to me, and I just understood it in the context that I just experienced Guru Shakti. I've been waiting for that as a Vaishnava. I've been waiting for Guru Shakti. It was going to come, and I got it. So once I got it, I knew what path I had to follow. But we never know where we're going to end up, do we? You know, it's interesting. Okay, does that sort of Aldo? Is it Aldo?
That archetype of the woman clothed with the sun.
Yes.
With the dragon ready to eat the child as soon as it's been born.
Yes.
That symbol in the Revelation is overlooked completely. Christians I think it's maybe an embarrassment about it. You brought up something that it's actually hidden. We're unconscious of it because it's never talked about, that archetype.
In fact, I can prove from just that one chapter, that one imagery,
yes,
that the whole idea of the fall of angels is mythology. It's mythology. From that one chapter, I can prove that irrefutably. I mean, it would take a moment to do. But let's just say that Swedenborg found that all angels were once humans on Earth, and all demons were once humans on Earth, and that it's our consciousness evolving or devolving. But we have freedom. The divine gives us that freedom to become who we want to become. But this idea that, you know, there was a fall of angels is actually mythology. And they use that very chapter to come up with that mythology, and it totally doesn't fit. But I won't go there right now. But thank you for bringing that up. It's the penultimate archetype of consciousness, you know, the human race consciousness shifting and changing.
And the child is actually whisked away and kept safe for a long period.
3.5 years.
Yeah.
That's very symbolic, okay, because that's why you're looking out there and going, why? It's getting worse. This 7 is the whole, 3.5 is part way there. Okay, so it's very important. All that, I won't go into the symbolism of it right now because it would take too long, but it's very significant. And that's us. We're often being whisked away. We're seeing the horror externally, and if you're not careful, your senses will overload you. One of the images I was thinking about putting in tonight and I didn't was from The Matrix, you know, the red pill and the blue pill. There's a movie where the guy's offered, Neo's offered the pill. Do you want the red pill that'll wake you up, or the blue pill and go back to sleep in you know? But what we talk about today, in our culture, we evolve that, and we now talk about the black pill. Anybody heard of the black pill? You've heard of the black pill? Would you like to know what the black pill is? That's where you've taken so many red pills, right? You're now discouraged. You've eaten too much truth, and you're now horrified and discouraged. How's the human race ever going to do this? So you take a pill, a red pill, and you integrate. That's what the 7 days teaches us. this, you have a sudden flash of light, right? You're going along in your spiritual process and suddenly you go, oh, I'm seeing this for the first time in a new way. That's the time to stop, learn to lift out of your ego and observe this principle at work in you. New Earth is the Buddhist state. You know, before enlightenment, chop wood, carry water. After enlightenment, chop wood, carry water. In other words, New Earth is now re-engage with everyday life and let that truth integrate. And if you integrate properly, you won't black pill yourself. But too many people are absorbing too much truth too quickly. They're not integrating, and so they become despondent, discouraged. Okay, it's just too easy to do that.
And they get called conspiracy theorists.
Yeah. I'm sorry, it's conspiracy fact because it all came true. Yeah, what were you going to say?
It's just on that fallen angels, the symbology of it, how yes. In that very chapter they say, you know, two-thirds are still not fallen and one-third's fallen.
Right.
And in the occult literature, Michael, the leader of the two-thirds, he's number 666, which is, you know, 66.6. That's two-thirds.
Right.
And then the Antichrist, he wants to turn two-thirds of the earth to the 666 number.
Right.
And that, but then it's the same with all that devil and serpent stuff. Like, it's like how Carl Jung was saying that it was all going to come up again. And even the New Age and UFOlogies, the bad guys are the reptiles, and they're controlling Hollywood and trying to program us to the negative side, apparently. But how do you defeat them? You have Christ consciousness and you rise above it so they don't feel fear.
And whether that's true or not,
yeah, it's
the solution, is Christ consciousness, isn't it? So we can get caught up in is it true or not, or we can exactly just get on with the process. My understanding of 666 here is this idea of six repeating itself indefinitely, right? Yeah. So you're forever going through battles, never coming into the seven, never finding peace, because you're in beast consciousness. You're in sensual consciousness. You're not coming into angelic consciousness. Okay, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, interesting. You mentioned the devil. I take quite interest in him. If it is him, it probably may not be. But it's interesting when you look at the God thing, because I read through the Bible and lots of stuff years ago.
Yes.
And it says that God, and there's multiple gods, there's God, the Son, and Father, but God's basically made everything. Mm-hmm. And he made the devil. And he had the gift of prophecy. It says all the way, he knows exactly the ramifications of his act. Mm-hmm. So when he made the devil, and the devil didn't turn out very well, it would have been a deliberate act for the then outcome, which is the only way people I know seem to evolve past a certain level, is to have to challenge, is to challenge by their own dark side, other people's dark side, in order to venture forward. It's just a developmental phase, and that's where the devil comes in.
Look, it is. Because if you think about it, if I said, describe love to me, right? Describe love. You'll struggle. Mm-hmm. But I like the analogy of mother holding brand new baby she's just given birth to. Mm-hmm. Father standing next to it looking, I didn't know you a minute ago. Now I'm so in love, I'll die for you. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to see love in action, right? But we also need to see evil. To know what evil is. And so this is a process where we encounter our shadow side and then we encounter our good side, and we keep going through these processes because this is how we've got to learn, grow and transcend it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, you know.
The two legs that you're talking about, could that also be equated to the concept of duality? Like in the Advaita Vedanta, they talk about things, you know, this being a dual world that we live in. Like we live
it's a nice tie-in. I hadn't thought of that before. That's
right.
A lovely tie-in.
Okay.
But see, this is an example of how sacred text can speak to everyone a little bit differently, but it is speaking to you, isn't it?
Mm.
But you've got to know the language. When you understand that Genesis to Revelation is talking in the language of angels, dreams and visions, that's what it is. It's talking, and then we learn to read that, then suddenly the imagery of two legs and the duality of it, you know, means a lot more to you, doesn't it?
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Any other thoughts, questions, issues?
Do you think it's a bit of a coincidence that Swedenborg started his experiences when he was 57 and went on for 27 years?
Right.
And then you had the 7 days. I never really thought of that.
I never thought about that either. Yeah. I mean, that's fascinating, isn't it?
Return.
Yeah.
It's a certain return. 57, 84 is Uranus return.
Yeah. Yeah. Look, there is no coincidences. There is only divine incidences, and God incidences, or coincidences. But it's whether we see them or not. Whether we can, if we have the knowledge to understand numbers, gematria, or whatever, we can start to see patterns and things, isn't it? Yeah, that's really good, Chris. Yeah.
Multiple, seven comes up a lot, seven chakras, 7 days of the week,
seven's
mentioned in the Bible a lot.
And this is a point I like to push, is that okay?
Yeah.
Seven is not God's number. Right? No, all numbers belong to the divine. Yes. Seven is the number of wholeness. Let's not forget that dragon, you know, the snake, when in the garden turned into the dragon, it had seven heads, so it must be God too. Like, you know, no, seven just means complete. That's where we have a week, and we say we're complete when we have a week.
But I was thinking with that serpent with the seven heads that was going to devour her child.
Yes.
So I was thinking that each head was related to a different sense, like, you know, your sight, your hearing, and so forth.
Yeah.
So five of those, your sixth sense, but what's the seventh one? So
can I run a little counter to that?
Yeah.
We talk about this, don't we, Chris? You don't have a sixth sense. You have another whole five set of senses.
Ah, yes. So
we ten, actually. So we have the spiritual eyes, which is how we actually see through the... Yeah, yeah. Mm. No, it's a good point.
And then there's the knowing. There's the seventh.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but I like what you're doing.
But
see,
that's the concept.
But this is what we're meant... This is what we're meant to do. We're meant to work with the text as it speaks to us. But I want you to really take this away, okay? That the freedom that Swedenborg talks about in this golden age is about us all learning to connect with the divine our way.
Mm-hmm.
I can't come in and say, oh no, don't do it like that.
Mm.
That's not right. It's for you to have your connection to the divine. And if it's going for a walk in the park, well, do it. You know. But I do believe as we go deeper and deeper into this golden age, everything will become a spiritual practice. You might go fishing and you'll connect with the divine. Mm-hmm. Cooking, you know, making love. Why should these things be disconnected? And once it's integrated, it won't be. Yeah, okay, so there we go. That's my talk. God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So this idea, when you're connecting with the divine and you get peace, you even transcend your intellectual side. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding. And that's how I, honestly, when things are falling apart, and we all know that they do and are, I connect back with that peace and everything's okay again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, it is for me.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so leave that at that. Let's go and have a cup of tea and coffee. Great. And mingle with God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So this idea, when you're connecting with the divine and you get peace, you even transcend your intellectual side. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding. And that's how I, honestly, when things are falling apart, and we all know that they do and are, I connect back with that peace and everything's okay again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, it is for me.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so leave that at that. Let's go and have a cup of tea and coffee.
Great.
And